Specifically or especially to people who have loved ones in Iraq or who themselves have served in Iraq or Afghanistan or in the other many, many places where the U.S. has troops around the world?
Absolutely. I think everybody knew that while the show was about Korea, we were actually talking about Vietnam, and in fact, we were talking about war in general, the insanity of war, and the fact that it is, you know, as I keep saying, war is not, blood is not spilled without cost. There's always a terrible, terrible human cost to war, and that we forget that in the noise that's made by the war-provoking machine and the drums and the blather of the media, particularly in around the Iraq War, the blather of the media that kept repeating and acting as a megaphone for the Bush administration's lies about the Iraq War and their invasion of Afghanistan, I felt was the same thing.
Mm. What did you think of Barack Obama getting the Nobel Peace Prize?
You know, I'm pleased. I think it requires some things of him, but I think it's also a statement on the part of the international community that there's been a shift, and they recognize that shift, that at least that there is indication that there's going to be a new approach on the part of the United States of America to its relationship with the rest of the world. And I think that's a very good thing. People say he hasn't done anything to earn it. That may be the case, but I think it then creates a kind of debt he owes us. Now he's got to make peace.
He and we did get George W. Bush out of office.
That's exactly right, and I think the international community is thrilled that George W. Bush is out of office.
You traveled around the country in Of Mule and Men in 2008 at the time where people were expressing their hopes of change before the election. What do you think connected those people, and are they still connected?
I think there's a lot of confusion now, but there is still hope. I think what connected them was hope, this sense that this man, this uncharacteristic politician who was talking about change, who was talking about hope, was talking about the sorts of things that stir people's juices. After 8 years of having been lied to and twisted and manipulated and made more fearful, here was somebody who was talking about possibility, and I think that really came together in people's hearts and minds. And I think there is still a great pool, a residual pool of that hope, hoping that he will make good on his promises. And I share it. I was frustrated when he said, let's move forward, not back, let's not look back at the administration behind us and hold them accountable. Although he didn't use those words, but that's effectively what looking forward, not back, means. When he said, we're not going to prosecute the torturers, when he said many of the things he said, I find it very frustrating. But I also try to understand that being the President of the United States means you have a task before you of bringing together a lot of people in order to make things happen. And he's trying to do that maybe to a fault, in my view, trying to reach across the line in spite of the fact that they keep thumbing their nose at him and calling him names and subverting him in every way possible. So I continue to hope, and the people I run into, although a significant amount of confusion is setting in, I will say.
You participated in a campaign for single-payer health care.
I did.
And you continue to support real reform.
Yes.
And universal guaranteed quality health care.
Right. Do you know something about that?
Do you think we'll get a step closer to it sometime soon?
Well, I continue to believe that we're going to get a health care reform bill through Congress. Let me go out on a limb and say I still cling to the belief that they're going to have a robust public option in it. I know it's being fought tooth and nail, but I think that there is still a very, very strong possibility that we're going to come up with one, because every committee that has come up with one, except the Finance Committee, has one in it.
4 out of 5. Funny how we talk about the fifth one.
Yes, isn't it though?
Let me ask you what people ask me, and then I'm going to open it up to everybody. If you've got questions, Mike's going to be here to answer your questions for a little while. But one of the questions people ask me is, you have all this optimism, and you describe in your book all these great pockets of progressive thought and engagement and action for change. But we still have a country that seems yet to accept war as a solution,
yep,
seems still more than 50%, I'm afraid it's close to two-thirds, supports the death penalty. Maybe I'm wrong. 50%?
No, it's close to two-thirds, you're right.
Close to two-thirds. That still seems to accept the notion that, well, if our jails are filled, it must be because we suddenly had an epidemic of criminality,
yep,
and it particularly hit young people and people of color, and we're not going to look any closer than that. On healthcare, I'm just going to put in a plug, we still have a healthcare system that charges women as much as 48% more for premiums than men, and that only 14 states require maternity coverage for women.
God.
It is legal to discriminate. It is legal to deny women full maternity care. And when the insurers are asked how do they possibly justify this, they say maternity is a choice. Which one hopes that it is, but not exactly a pre-existing condition.
But they do claim now, as I understand it, some, that spousal abuse, violence in the home, is a pre-existing condition.
Yes, and deny coverage.
Which means that coverage will be denied. Unbelievable.
So, all of that being true, you have in the one hand this, and in the other hand this. I want good answers for that question next time I'm asked.
Well, listen, I believe in the fundamental principles of the country. I believe very strongly in it, and I think that they are engraved on the hearts and minds of most people, even though they have been beaten down to the point of sometimes non-recognition. To take the death penalty, I've been working against the death penalty for 30 years, and the death penalty, which was in late 80s and early 90s, was around 85 to 90% support. Is now, if you just simply ask the question, do you support the death penalty for capital crimes, yes or no, about 62% of the people will say yes. But if you say, if you had the option of life in prison without the possibility of parole or the death penalty, which would you prefer? More people would prefer life without parole. So we're making progress. We're making progress by pointing out how inappropriate the death penalty is, that it's racist, that it's only used against the poor, that it's full of error, that we have 138 people now who are convicted and sentenced to death and are now, thanks to a lot of hard work on the part of their defense teams, now walking the streets having been exonerated. We found in Texas recently that a man who was executed was in fact not guilty, as he claimed, of the crime of arson that killed his two children. It was in fact an accidental fire. What I find galling is that the death penalty is really not about justice at all. It's about politics. And it's never been made more evident than in Texas, where Governor Rick Perry, who presided over the execution of Cameron Willingham, was faced with the fact that a Texas body was going to make a determination about whether or not they had made a mistake and killed an innocent man. And the day before they were to meet, he dismissed three of the members of that commission who are now to be replaced, and subsequently dismissed a fourth one who are going to be replaced, obviously, by his political cronies. But I think the obviousness of that, I think the ham-handedness of this kind of behavior begins to expose people, and that's why I believe these poll numbers are falling. I believe people are beginning to understand that there's something very wrong with this system. Even George Will, a conservative columnist, said in one of his columns, after reading Barry Scheck's book about the Innocence, the work of the Innocence Project, he said, conservatives are supposed to be skeptical about government programs. The death penalty is a government program. How can they not be skeptical about the killing of people in our country? So I think we're moving. I will tell you a very odd story. I was here in January, and I did Sean Hannity's show.
Mm.
Sean and I have debated... Sean and I have debated this issue and debated many other issues over time, and the first thing he said to me was, you know, we've debated this issue for a lot of years, and I want you to know you've persuaded me. I now oppose the use of the death penalty.
Oh, my God, my chin is on the table.
Yes, and he said that on the air.
Thank you, Mike.
Absolutely.
Is there one voice in your head in those moments, and you've traveled all over the world, and I've been particularly moved by some of what you've said about what people in Latin America have told you, a part of the world where there's real change, I think, happening. Is there a voice in your head that's the voice you hear when you think, I am just too tired to do this today?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And whose is it?
Well, it's mine that says, you stupid fool, what are you doing? Do you? And my father, who says, you stupid. Yeah. No, it's, you know, sure, there are times when you just get so damn tired and so frustrated and so beaten down. But if I may, I'll tell you a story. I was in El Salvador, as I mentioned, in 1982.